Hachette Audio presents The Spy's Daughter, written by Adam Brookes, read by Colin Mace.
In the past, espionage activity was typically directed towards obtaining political and military intelligence. These targets remain of critical importance. But in today's technology-driven world, the intelligence requirements of a number of countries are wider than before. They now include communications technologies, IT, energy, scientific research, defense, aviation, electronics, and many other fields. Intelligence services, therefore, are targeting commercial as well as government-related organizations. They sometimes do this on behalf of state-owned or sponsored companies in their own countries. MI5.org.uk. We are talking here of an elaborate, comprehensive system for spotting foreign technologies, acquiring them by every means imaginable, and converting them into weapons and competitive goods. There is nothing like it anywhere else in the world. The system is enormous, befitting a nation of 1.3 billion, and operates on a scale that dwarfs China's own legitimate S&T enterprise. Chinese Industrial Espionage, William C. Hanners, James Mulvenon, and Anna B. Puglisi. Life is first boredom, then fear. Philip Larkin. Prologue. Great Falls, Maryland. The recent past. The sound of the shot made the outdoor diners at a nearby restaurant lift their eyes and turn, wondering, from their conversations. They looked across the parking lot, towards the trees. There, partly hidden by azalea bushes and undergrowth, a car rocked momentarily on its suspension. Startled birds rose in the warm air. The first intrepid soul to leave his table and approach the vehicle was a former Marine of broad back and strong stomach. He picked his way past the vegetation and peered through the windscreen, then backed away, shaking his head. Whether in sorrow or disgust, it was hard to say. A single body, he reported, male, in the driver's seat. The back of the head shot away, suggesting a self-inflicted wound. Blood all over the place. The hand holding the weapon was limp and curiously positioned, turned back on itself in the well between the seats. The diners called their children to them. Some paid their bills and left hurriedly. The police and paramedics arrived. Then a detective, then a forensic investigator from the office of the chief medical examiner. The male in the driver's seat was declared dead. The investigator picked his way around the car, leaned into it, made copious notes. Photographs were taken and evidence bagged and tagged. Finally, the body was maneuvered from the car and laid upon a gurney. The dead man was of 60-some years. He wore a well-cut suit and a silk tie for the day of his death. He appeared prosperous, trim, fit, lightly tanned. He wore a silver beard, trimmed close to the jaw. On his right wrist was an extremely expensive watch, a Breguet. This was odd, thought the forensic examiner, since it would suggest left-handedness, yet the weapon, a SIG 357, was in the right. The forensic examiner pondered the strangeness of it all. Out here on the edge of the city, in the trees, near a popular restaurant and a pretty canal, a place for day trips, for hikes. The suit and tie, the sense of orderliness and authority they hinted at. And as he did so, the FBI arrived, as he knew they would. For the man's identity, quickly established from his wallet and the federal government identification tag in his inside pocket, was already sending tremors through Washington, D.C. He was, apparently, a senior official of the State Department. Not a diplomat, but an intelligence analyst by the name of Jonathan Monroe. And when such people, the holders of security clearances that allowed them into the most secret compartments of this most secretive of cities, took their own lives, all the worst assumptions frothed and bubbled around their cadavers. Was it corruption? Sex? Was he coerced? Compromised? Cuckolded? Was he, God help us all, a spy? Two FBI special agents waited politely to talk to him, and for a moment the examiner looked skyward at the circling birds, felt the sun on his face. Such a death was not uncommon in Washington. The pressure, the secrecy, the sheer viciousness of the place ate away at people. But such a death was rarely uncomplicated. Part 1. The Possible. Chapter 1. Beijing. The Recent Past. Granny Poon came in dry as a bone this time. She carried no handheld, no tracker, nothing to leak a signal, however faint. She would leave no signature, no spore. She would float through the digital medium like a dust mote in dark, quiet air. She took a bus from the airport. She paid in cash and turned her face from the cameras that monitored her boarding. The bus crawled into the city and she watched the tower blocks creep past. The concrete rendered gold in the late summer sunlight. Bone dry. Alone. That was the way of it, she thought. She looked down at her hands, their liver spots, veins rising from the dry, papery skin. She wondered if this might, perhaps, be the last time. Let's see what this stupid old woman can do. The restaurant was packed with market traders and migrant workers, the air clattering and heavy with grease, the reek of sorghum spirit. They came here for the Shaanxi food, the bowls of fatty lamb and shaved noodles. She had come in good time to watch from the scrubby park across the street, sitting still in the warm twilight, clutching a walking stick and her purse. She had made two passes before entering, tottering along the sidewalk in dark glasses, wheezing. Now she occupied a corner table. The waitress smiled at her, called her Ai, Auntie, a sweet girl. She ordered cat's ear noodles heaped with garlic bolts and tomatoes, the broth thick with cumin, laced with black vinegar. The girl caught her accent, the sibilant sing-song of the South, and smiled, tilting her head questioningly. Eileen Poon just nodded. And now Eileen waited and watched. She waited for a particular moment, one rapidly approaching, whose exact location in time had been determined months previously, perhaps years. She watched for the anomaly, the ripple on the surface of the crowd. Not long now. The girl came and placed before her a steaming bowl, plastic chopsticks wrapped in a napkin, a glass of tea. She picked at the noodles, letting the seconds tick down. She allowed her gaze to float and settle. Float and settle. Nothing. Nothing but the bark and clatter of the restaurant. Steam rising from the bowls and curling in the afternoon light. The ruddy-faced men leaning into their food, pouring the sorghum spirit from the little green bottles, tossing it back. Time. Now. She laid her chopsticks down, got shakily to her feet, one hand leaning on the table, the other clutching her purse. The sweet waitress was there, asking if she needed anything. Sessio? She said. Toilet. The girl gestured to the back of the restaurant. A corridor. Eileen Poon tottered past the busy tables down the corridor, past stacks of greasy chairs, an empty fish tank. The noise receded. The door to the toilet was of plywood and stood half open. She went in, felt for a light switch, locked the door behind her, and stifled her breathing against the ammonia stench. From a squat toilet, a pipe snaked up the wall to the cistern. She took a pair of latex gloves from her purse and put them on. She ran her hand up and down the pipe, feeling behind it. Nothing there. She opened the toilet paper dispenser. Nothing. Beneath the hand wash basin, she found a cupboard. She opened it and ran her hands around the inside. And just there, deep in the cupboard's filthy recesses, taped to the underside of the basin, a packet of white rabbit milk candy. Eileen worked the packet free, peeled the tape from it, and put it in a plastic bag. She threw the tape and the latex gloves into the toilet and put the plastic bag containing the candy in her purse. She waited for a moment, steadied herself. She flushed the toilet and washed her hands, unlocked the door, and made her way back down the corridor.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.